Hello, I'm Joe Stiles with Ignited by Truth. At Ignited by Truth, we are bringing to light the truth of the teachings of the Catholic Church and igniting in all hearts a love for the faith. Welcome to the Truth Series. I'm pleased to introduce Father Donald Calloway, MIC. Father Calloway is with the Congregation of Marian Fathers of the Immaculate Conception of the Most Blessed Virgin Mary, and his talk is titled, The Truth About Saint Joseph and Spiritual Warfare.
I'm Father Donald Calloway, and it is a real blessing and a privilege to be able to be part of this conference. And I was asked to give a talk specific to St. Joseph. I think, as a lot of people know, I've really been pushing St. Joseph lately because I think we need him in a big way. And they asked if I could have my topic be about St. Joseph and spiritual warfare. And I thought, well, that is a brilliant combination, because that's one of the reasons why I put this book together, which I'll talk about here in a little bit in more depth. You know, right now in the world, we have a lot going on. There is so much going on, as a matter of fact, that it's one of the reasons why we have to have these kind of conferences online right now, because there is a pandemic. There's so much going on that many people are not able to meet in large gatherings and groups because of this situation. And it's got a lot of people very concerned, very fearful, very worried about the future. Some people have even lost their jobs. There's a lot of anxiety in the world right now because of this. And then also, to add even more, as everybody's saying, 2020 is quite the year, we also have this civil unrest going on in the United States, and it's actually seems to have kind of gone everywhere now around the world. And a lot of it has to do with people who started out, you know, in protest, but now it's very obvious that a lot of it has turned into riots and looting and all kind of damaging of personal property. And another reason that people are afraid and worried about the future and where things are headed. And it's an election year, so we've got a lot on our plate right now. So there's a lot going on. But not just in the world, even in the church, there's a lot going on. There is a lot of division. There's a lot of chaos. There's a lot of confusion. There's a lot of spiritual warfare, even in the church. Now, you might think, Father, what are you getting at there? That doesn't seem right that something like that would happen in the church. Well, it's not right. But Our Lady herself has even told us about these things. In many of her approved apparitions, the Blessed Virgin Mary has told us that there would be days that would come that would be like this. So, you know, just backing up to 1917, to Fatima, when Our Lady came, she told the children many things about the current world situation at that time, about the war, and if they prayed the rosary, the war would come to an end. She told them many things about doing penance, about fasting, and these are powerful spiritual weapons. And as many of you know, I've been really pushing the last 6 to 8 years or so, the rosary big time, trying to get people to take that more seriously, bringing it into the lives of individuals, of couples and their marriage and family life, into the life of parishes and dioceses. And I continue to do that, But there's something interesting. Going back to Fatima again, where Our Lady actually identified herself as the Lady of the Rosary, it was at that same apparition on October 13th, 1917, the last apparition of Fatima, when Saint Joseph appeared. He was there at Fatima. It's almost like a lot of people have forgotten this aspect of the Fatima message. All three children testified that he was there, and he was holding the Christ child in his arms, somewhat similar to the painting you see behind me. And simultaneously, Saint Joseph and the child Jesus, they blessed the world. Now, I think that that is very, very significant, because God certainly knew what was going to be coming in the, you know, middle and second half of the 20th century and into the, you know, our current century with the attack on the family. You know, Our Lady said that her Immaculate Heart would triumph, but I don't think that her Immaculate Heart is going to triumph until we get the family right, because this is a large part of what is going on in the streets in cities across America, there is a real anger. And if you look at a lot of these people that are involved in a lot of these movements that are rioting and looting, they come from broken homes. Many of them have not had virtuous fathers to be modeling for them things that should be done in the right way. And so they're going about to bringing change in the wrong way. And so if we look back at that Fatima message, we can see that maybe it's time now to emphasize that fatherly role in order to bring some order out of this chaos, to bring, you know, some virtue back in a world that has really gone bonkers. And in a big way, there's been a movement of the Holy Spirit already at work in the church, in the lives of the faithful, to bring an emphasis to one particular father, and that's Saint Joseph. Now, don't take my words for it. Sister Lucia dos Santos, remember, the one of those three visionaries from Fatima, the one who lived to be 100 years old, only dying in, I think it was 2005, she said on one occasion that the final battle, remember, we're talking about spiritual warfare here, spiritual battle going on between the forces of light and the forces of darkness, between good and evil. She said that the final battle between good and evil would be fought over marriage and the family. Well, my friends, I think it's pretty obvious that we are in this battle right now. All you have to do is turn on the television, and every night on the news, you will see, whether it's in Portland or Seattle or Chicago or Philadelphia or somewhere in Minnesota, wherever, there's all kinds of chaos. There's a battle going on. There are even movements that talk about wanting to restructure all of society. And if you look at their programs, if you go to their websites, it's about the deconstruction of traditional marriage. It's about promoting LGBTQ and everything else. But this is not of God. This is not pleasing to God. And this is exactly what Our Lady was talking about, why we need to pray the rosary, why we need to do penance, why we need to be praying for society, not just for wars to end, to also prevent them. Because right now there's a real sense of revolution in the air. There's a sense that we are in a time of change right now. And what do we do? How do we return to virtue? How do we restore order in a chaotic household? How do we bring about renewal in the church? Because as I said, there's a lot of things in the church right now that are not good. And I could go through a long list, a long litany to prove that to you. But I'll just mention a few, just a few. You know, right before the pandemic happened, which basically, let's just say that it happened in March of 2020 is when things really got underway with the things starting to shut down in major ways. Well, right before that, there was a survey taken in the United States among your average Catholic about their belief in the real presence of Jesus Christ in Holy Communion, in the Blessed Sacrament. The survey said, 69% of Catholics do not believe in the real presence of Jesus Christ. They do not believe that he is there, body, blood, soul, and divinity in Holy Communion. They don't believe it. 69%. Let's just round it up and say 70% of Catholics do not believe in this fundamental teaching. This is the most fundamental teaching. This is the source and summit of the Christian life, the Eucharistic presence of our Lord, the Lamb of God present in the host. We went into the pandemic with this, and now still many churches are closed, or they're certainly not like it used to be, many parishes, and they may never return to what they used to be. We're in a serious situation. In Ireland this year, now I'm not singling out Ireland for any particular reason, it's just because I heard this the other day, and it was so shocking, I'd like to tell you this. Ireland, you remember Ireland, back in the day, Ireland, the priests were everywhere around the world. The Irish evangelized the world in every parish in the 1940s. You know, there was a Father O'Malley. You know, they were everywhere, the Irish, and they were doing great work. Do you know how many men in the entire country of Ireland are going to be ordained to the sacred priesthood in 2020? One. Only one. We've got a serious situation. We've got so many problems that it's a time for a great renewal of holiness. Now, getting back to those things that are happening, you know, in the world, 52%, and this is not just me saying this, Father Calloway, these, you can look these things up, you can Google it and find it, 52% of families today, households today, do not have a father. More than half do not have a father in their home. In the Black community, it's in the 70% range. We've got a serious problem today. That's why I believe that one of the many spiritual weapons that I believe the Holy Spirit wants to bring onto the battlefield today is a weapon that has often been neglected and really hasn't been used much. Now, we've got the rosary, and the popes and saints and Our Lady herself has been championing this for centuries, and we need to keep doing that. We need to keep praying that rosary for sure. If you're not doing it, I urge you, please start to pray the rosary. We need to fast. Fasting is powerful. One of my professors when I was in seminary said that fasting is prayer squared. It's a double punch in the spiritual life, and it is. It's very powerful. There's something else that we need to add to this arsenal because of the attack that's happening. The attack on the family. The attack on marriage. You know, today, many cultures, most cultures, have sought to redefine marriage. And they'll say that one man can marry another man, or a woman can marry a woman. But we know that this is madness. This goes against, you know, human nature and common sense. It just doesn't work. It's not how God ordained it, desires it to be done. But today, many people, they don't care. When we have this happening, when we have people even confused about their own gender, today, men claim that they can identify as a woman, and many societies give them all the rights to protect that, to call them whatever they want to be called, when everybody knows that it's a man, and vice versa. So where do we go? Where do we look to? Well, let me put it this way. If you saw that there was a bridge that was falling down and you wanted to shore it up, you wanted to make it that it did not fall down, would you not go to the blueprint? Would you not look at how this thing was put together in the first place to find out where it needed to be strengthened, what needed to be corrected so that you could make it once again stable and firm? Sure, that just makes sense. Well, if men are being attacked today, and they are, many men today, I think, don't know what it means to be a man. And a lot of the problems that we're having today is because we have not had those leaders, those sacrificial leaders, giving themselves for their families, for their culture, for their country, and for their church even, because we all know about the scandals in the priesthood. Many fathers have failed because they don't know where to look. Many men have failed because they don't know where to look. We live in a pornographic, filthy, perverse era where so many men have been corrupted by this. So many men, even when they feel something in their heart that they want to act in those traditional ways that they might have remembered that their grandfather acted in, or they read about in books. But as soon as they do, the culture says that's toxic. We don't want that kind of masculinity. And so in light of that, that's where I firmly believe that God himself is wanting us to unpack a treasure that has been with us for 2,000 years and yet has not fully been discovered in its wonder and majesty. And this treasure is Saint Joseph, the head of the Holy Family. Because if you think about it, Jesus himself placed himself under that authority, under that leadership, that sacrificial servant leadership of Saint Joseph, and grew into the fullness of his manhood under the roof of Saint Joseph. See, this is why I've been a priest for 17 years now, and oftentimes the majority of people that I see in church and participating in church activities are women. Now, there's nothing wrong with that, of course. But where are the men? Where are they? Why are they not present? Well, oftentimes it's because they haven't been given an example from their own father of being a religious man, of being a pious, devout man. They haven't seen their own father on his knees in prayer. Many people have seen an example of a fatherhood that has been abusive in one way or another, whether it's emotional, physical, or God forbid, sexual, or something of that nature. Many people sadly have experienced that. And that's a hard wound to heal. So if we're going to heal it, if we're going to restore it, if we're going to shore this thing up and correct it where it needs to be corrected, we need to go to the model. We need to go to the man that God gave so many graces to, that God called Father. And this is an extraordinary thing. You know, they tell me around the world, I have traveled everywhere, and in every culture that I've gone to, they always say that when a little baby says its first words, normally the first thing that the baby says is dada, not mama. Now, why is that? It's simply easier to pronounce, I think, when you're a little baby. The dada just comes better than a mama. That's fascinating. Because, you know, think about the household of Nazareth, where Jesus, Mary, and Joseph lived, or even starting off in Bethlehem, where our Lord himself was born, gathered there. It's an extraordinary thing to think that the least holy member of the holy family, now they're all holy, but the one who would be the third in third place, he's the one who had the headship of that family unit. Even though his son, not biologically, of course, but his foster son, Jesus, was God. Jesus is God. He's perfect. He's divine. Mary, though not God, she's a creature just like you and me, but she's perfect. She's without sin, flawless. But who was it in the home of Bethlehem and then in Egypt and then eventually in Nazareth where the Holy Family lived? Who was it who led the prayers? It was Joseph, the man of the house. That is profound. See, today we've flipped it around. And many men I've heard will say, well, you know, I leave those things up to my wife to do. She's just better at it. And she's closer to God than I am. Okay, she may well be and probably is, but that's not the point. You have a role to play. You have a place in that family unit that if you do not fulfill, there are going to be repercussions. So, further studies done in our times have shown that when a family's prayer life and religious observance is only left up to the leadership of the mother, of the wife to do, which there's nothing wrong with that, of course, because sometimes women, they have to do that if there's no father present or some other circumstances. Many, many women have been very heroic if the father has died or some other circumstances are present. But normally, in a family that has a father, when it's the woman who does all of these things, it doesn't have enough stick. When the children leave the home, the likelihood of them not continuing on with the practice of the faith, they may get it later on down the road, but when they leave, it doesn't stick. Not as strong as it could if the father was the one who led the prayers and took the family to church and led the grace before meals and prayed the rosary as a family. It was the father who leads it. The percentage of the children staying with the faith immediately after they leave the home goes up exponentially. No wonder we have a crisis today. No wonder we have rioting and looting in our streets, because so many of these people who are doing this, they haven't had a good father. No wonder we've had so much confusion even in the church, because we've seen the failures of our fathers in so many of these areas. And so many parishes have been taken over by women. Not bad intentioned. Oh, of course not. God bless them. Oh, I tell you, I probably wouldn't be a Catholic without some of these pious women. I'm eternally grateful for what they did. But there's an order. And when that order is not being observed as God wants it to be observed, there's going to be problems. There's going to be things that come up that are going to be destructive. Well, we're experiencing that in the world and in the church. So, Saint Joseph, the man who was the one that God himself looked up to and wanted to be like. You know, this is an amazing thing. If you think about when God became man in the second person of the Blessed Trinity, taking on human nature, he wanted to share the same facial characteristics of one particular person on earth. And that was the Blessed Virgin Mary, because they're biologically linked. He came into the world through her womb. And so Jesus, in all likelihood, shares the same facial characteristics on some level as his mother. He probably has maybe had her cheekbones or her chin or eye sockets or something. Just like I look like my mother, and most people look on some level like their mother, they share those characteristics. Jesus would have shared those characteristics. They would have looked similar. That's amazing. Shows you the unique dignity of the Blessed Virgin Mary, that when God wanted to look similar to someone, he chose her beautiful face. Amazing. But when God wants to imitate somebody, when God wants to work like a man, when God wants to walk like a man, when God wants to chop wood like a man, where did he look? He looked at Joseph. He looked at Joseph. He saw his example of masculine strength and virtue and imitated that. Jesus himself said on one occasion, in relation to speaking about his heavenly father, but it applies also to his relationship with Saint Joseph, Jesus said, "I can only do and say what I see my father doing and saying." Wow. Think about that. I wonder if Jesus laughed like Saint Joseph. I wonder if he sat like Saint Joseph. I wonder if he had the mannerisms of Saint Joseph. I wonder, you know, if he had the accent of Saint Joseph. I don't see how he could not have had these things. Every boy learns these things from his father. And when you learn it from a virtuous father like Saint Joseph, it makes you a gentleman. It makes you a gentleman. In the Gospel of Luke, it says that Jesus, as a young boy, grew in wisdom and stature before God and man under the watchful care of Mary and Joseph. And Joseph. See, in this crisis, and the reason I mentioned that passage in the Gospel is because in the crisis that we're experiencing in the culture and even in the church on some level, it's now time to bring in the model father, to bring in the one who was a protector, a defender, who sacrificed himself for those who were entrusted to his care. We need to bring Saint Joseph in and close the gap, because many of us, and rightly so, have consecrated ourselves to the Blessed Virgin Mary. And my friends, that is one of the greatest things you can do in your spiritual life. But now it's time also to consecrate ourselves to Saint Joseph. Because God's desire for the norm of family life is that all children be entrusted to a mother and a father. We need to bring the father and his important role back into society, back into the workplace, back into families, back into the parishes, back into the diocese, back into the church. We need to get this right. And we need people to understand what it is that we're doing. Not wanting to say that men are better than women, because we know that that's not true. As a matter of fact, the majority of the people at the foot of the cross were not men, but women. The feminine genius and its wonder is a gift from God. But if we leave out the important role of manhood, we're going to have problems. And that's what we've been experiencing. So we've got to get it right. We don't mean to bring in back a role of manhood that is presented as an ogre or using his physical strength and authority in the wrong way. We've had far too much of that. Abusing those who are entrusted to your care for your own benefit. We've got to end that. That's why we've had this pornographic, filthy era that we live in, where men simply use beauty for their own gratification. This is wrong. Therefore, we need to look to Saint Joseph, the model of purity, the man who was married to the most beautiful woman who ever walked this planet and ever will. And yet he was so pure in his most chaste heart. He was sacrificial. He gave everything for those entrusted to his care. Well, my friends, getting specifically into how you can bring St. Joseph into your life. No matter what your vocation is, it doesn't matter what your vocation is. We all need St. Joseph. Just like we need the Blessed Virgin Mary to grow closer to Jesus Christ, we need St. Joseph as well. About 4 years ago, I was praying about all of this, you know, and I've been a priest 17 years now, and a lot of people coming up to me and saying, Father, my husband, this, and my children, and I just kept seeing this theme of the family wound, and it's being attacked by the evil one, and the father especially, so many fathers lacking in their presence, and especially a religious observance in their family life. I did a lot of research to find quotes on St. Joseph. And I put together a little book called St. Joseph Gems, a daily quote on St. Joseph for every day of the year, just as a little pious book. And it was great. I loved working on it. But when it was done, I had so much material that I thought to myself, you know, I've got more than on St. Joseph now than just a daily quote. So we've done that book. Great. But boy, it'd be great if I could do something with this, because there is such a need for St. Joseph. I'm really feeling the Holy Spirit telling me to do this. So I put out feelers across the world. I asked friends in Poland, in Croatia, down in Mexico, down in Argentina. Hey guys, has anybody in your culture ever created something like a consecration to St. Joseph, like St. Louis de Montfort did, a consecration to the Blessed Virgin Mary? Is something like that exist in your language or anywhere? And all of them, across the board, said no. No, Father. We have novenas and we have prayers and things to St. Joseph, but nothing like that. So I thought to myself, wow, now's the time for this. Somebody needs to do this. And I thought, well, I've got all the stuff right in front of me. I need to do a lot more research for sure and really unpack this. And so that's what I set out to do. I spent 3 years going around the world, doing the research, having translations done, things about St. Joseph that have never appeared in English, and other languages, of course, but not English. And so I thought, let's get that done. Let's get some commissioned artwork done. Let's present Joseph to the world, and even on some level to the church, so that we can right some of these wrongs and get some order restored to this chaotic, messed up household that we have. And that's what I ended up doing with the book, Consecration to St. Joseph. And what it is it's that same kind of model of St. Louis de Montfort, where for 33 days, you do readings, and then you pray the litany of St. Joseph, where his titles and honors and privileges are presented. And you know, that's an interesting point that I should mention. When I first started to put this book together, I wasn't sure exactly how to structure it. Because, you know, in the church, we don't have similar doctrines and dogmas about St. Joseph like we do with the Blessed Virgin Mary. So for St. Louis de Montfort, it was somewhat easy, although two dogmas of Our Lady came after he even lived, the Immaculate Conception and the Assumption. But nonetheless, there was more meat doctrinally that he could build his consecration on. So I thought to myself, how do I structure my book if it's going to be similar to his? Well, one day in prayer, I was praying the Litany of St. Joseph. And, you know, I had been praying that for quite some time, and it's a beautiful prayer. And all of a sudden, I started to count the titles. And I said, wait a minute here. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, went down. And it was something like 28 titles. And I said to myself, that's it. If I have an introduction, unpack one of those titles for every day, and then have a conclusion, we'll get 33 days, just like St. Louis de Montfort. That's brilliant. That works. And I thank the Holy Spirit for that. And that's what I set about to do. And so I built the structure, the template for the book on the Litany of St. Joseph, and then I unpack everything to help us in our current situation. So when we go through the Litany of St. Joseph, I unpack those titles, which are so needed today, and they are beautiful. And the sad thing is, most people are not even aware that there is a Litany of St. Joseph, officially approved by the church. It's a beautiful prayer. So some of these titles, for example, are St. Joseph as the glory of domestic life. What man do you know that you could say that man is the glory of domestic life? I hope you know some. Growing up, I didn't know many. No wonder I got into all the trouble that I did. Not putting all the blame on somebody else, of course. I'm responsible for my own actions. But I had three fathers before I was 10 years old, and none of them were St. Joseph in virtue. See, when you don't have that model, things go astray. When little girls don't have that protective father present, affirming in her life, they cry out for affirmation when they get into their teen years and the hormones are flowing. And they look for boys, they'll give them anything to be affirmed. This is why we need this father. That's why St. Joseph, another one of his titles in the litany, is called the Guardian of Virgins. He's the guardian of the Virgin, Our Lady, but he's also the guardian of virgins. How contrary is that to the world today, where in this filthy, perverse, sick, twisted times in which we live, we've flipped it around. We've turned it upside down. We should be the protectors of these great gifts. Or think about some of his other titles, the model of workers, the just man. How many men today are just worried about money and they'll do anything to get it? They'll go right over people, pay unjust wages, and do anything they can just to get more money. But that's not what St. Joseph did. That's not what he did at all. He was the one who was willing to live in poverty for his family, willing to actually go to Egypt where he didn't know anybody and they didn't have anything. Think about that. This is extraordinary. What he was willing to do for his wife and his son. They had gone down to take that census in Bethlehem from Nazareth. They had no idea they were going to be down there very long. And it ends up that our Lord was born there. And then Joseph receives a dream. The angel says, Herod is out to destroy the child, to kill the child, take the child and his mother and flee to Egypt. And he did. Basically, nothing on him. Didn't know the language. And they're probably not going to be very receptive to them in Egypt. But he did it. Many saints say that they were there 7 years. Now, we don't know exactly. We'll find out in the end. But it was a period of time. But he did it lovingly, sacrificially. And, you know, we should be so grateful for that. Because there's things in the life of St. Joseph that we don't often think about that our Lord and Our Lady are very cognizant of and are very grateful for. For example, you know, Herod wanted to kill the true bread come down from heaven, Jesus. Remember, Jesus was born in Bethlehem, which means house of bread in Hebrew. He was placed in a manger, from where we get the root word mangiare, eat. Remember in the Old Testament there was a Joseph sold into slavery by his brothers? Terrible, terrible thing. And his captors ended up taking Joseph to Egypt. And over a period of time, he actually became favored by Pharaoh and put in charge of all the granaries in Egypt. At that time, Egypt was known as the breadbasket of the world. Well, it was said that he had so much grain that it couldn't be counted. It was more numerous than the stars of the heavens. A famine came, and everybody from around the world came to Egypt looking for grain. Even Joseph's family, his brothers, who sold him into slavery, came. And you know the story. He played with them a little bit, hiding his identity, but then he revealed himself, and his own father came, and it was one grand, you know, family reunion. He forgave them, and he gave them bread. Joseph. Well, think about our Joseph, much greater than the old patriarch in the Old Testament. Our Joseph took our bread away from a lunatic who wanted to kill Jesus, into Egypt. Our Joseph took our bread into Egypt and raised him there, protected him, nourished him, and then out of Egypt he came to feed the nations with the true bread come down from heaven. Isn't that amazing? Most people don't see a connection between Joseph and the Eucharist, because we know that Joseph died sometime before our Lord's public ministry, and so we think, well, he wasn't there at the Last Supper. He didn't really have anything to do with all of that. Oh, no. Oh, no. The only reason you can receive the Eucharist today is because St. Joseph saved Jesus from Herod. That's how grateful we should be to St. Joseph. That's why one of his titles, he's called the Savior of the Savior. Now, you have to understand that correctly, of course. St. Joseph is not God. He's not the Messiah. He's not divine. But he did save Jesus from Herod. And that was so that Jesus could save us from eternal death, from sin. And there's more. There's more to this. Because a lot of people, they will say, well, St. Joseph really wasn't at the cross. So, you know, don't give him too much credit. He really didn't have much to do in the public ministry of Jesus and so forth. Well, hold on now. The only reason that Jesus could get to the cross and Mary as the new Eve get there as well is because of all the sacrifices that Joseph as the head of the Holy Family made for decades, protecting them, serving them, making sure that they could get to where they needed to be so the world could be redeemed. Oh, he wasn't there physically at the cross, but he was there in the heart of his wife and of his son. You better believe it. When Mary was watching her son be crucified, I guarantee you she was finding strength in the thoughts of all that Joseph had done for decades. Jesus dying on the cross, his heart pierced with the sword and blood and water coming out. That was the heart that rested so close to the heart of Joseph for decades, that grew in wisdom and strength and in the fullness of his manhood by imitating the heart of Joseph. He was there in the hearts of Jesus and Mary. And he's here now with us. He wants to be a part of our lives. He wants to help us in these difficult times. He wants men to learn how to be a head of a family in the right way, not as an ogre, not as a caveman, lording your authority and physical strength over. No, not at all. But serving, being willing to die for. We need this today. In the church, we need priests of this caliber. Men who are not taking advantage of the beauty entrusted to them and doing what they want with it, but serving that mystery, that sacred mystery. And so, my friends, I really pray that you would ask the Holy Spirit to reveal the greatness of St. Joseph in your life and in your particular vocation and circumstances in which you find yourself. We need him today. I could give you a long, long list, but you're going to have to get it in the book because it would take me a long time to go through it. It's at the beginning of the book. The Holy Spirit has been leading up to this because, you know, St. Joseph has always been loved by the church, for sure. St. Teresa of Avila greatly loved him. St. Thomas Aquinas, many saints. But they never really did anything too doctrinally about it. It was more of just a pious devotion, which is wonderful, and we should all have that. But now the time has come when the church is doing things doctrinally about St. Joseph. And isn't it interesting that it's in our time today, in light of everything that I've said about the attack on the family and masculinity and fatherhood? Starting in 1870, Blessed Pope Pius IX, the great pope, he declared St. Joseph the patron of the universal church. Now, patron comes from the root word pater, which means father. So when a woman is a patron, it's more like a parental. Well, with St. Joseph, it's very paternal. He made him the patron of the universal church in 1870. 9 years later, it didn't take very long, St. Joseph came in an apparition, in an approved apparition. Knock, Ireland. 9 years after that declaration, Knock, Ireland, St. Joseph came with Our Lady and with St. John the Evangelist and a lamb depicting our Lord as a Lamb of God. And in classic form, nobody said anything. St. Joseph didn't say anything. Mary didn't say anything. But it was a message of comfort to a people who were going through a great famine at that time. And it's an approved apparition. Shortly after that, we got the first encyclical on St. Joseph. You know, it took almost, 2,000 years to get an encyclical on St. Joseph. Well, it took 1,900 years. That's amazing. It's almost embarrassing, to be honest with you. The man who raised Jesus had no significant writing on him from a pope. Wow. It was Pope Leo XIII who did that. And it wasn't shortly after that, after Pope Leo XIII died in the early 20th century, that Our Lady came to Fatima, Portugal, and then St. Joseph came. As I mentioned at the beginning, on that last day, October 13, 1917, St. Joseph was there. Then Pope Pius X approved the litany of St. Joseph, and we got Joseph's name put in the Divine Praises, Blessed be St. Joseph, her most chaste spouse. We got the first theological journal about St. Joseph, Estudios Josefinos in Spain in the 1950s. There had never been anything like this before. New religious communities were founded to St. Joseph. Shrines were built to St. Joseph. Just think about St. Andre Bassett, who initiated the largest church basilica dedicated to St. Joseph in the entire world. That didn't happen until the 20th century in Montreal, Canada, the great oratory of St. Joseph. All of this stuff happened in the last 150 years because God knew that we were going to need St. Joseph. As a matter of fact, 1962, St. Joseph's name finally got put into the greatest and holiest of all prayers, the Mass. Isn't it amazing to think that for 1,962 years, St. Joseph's name was not said in the Holy Mass? That's amazing. But now it is. It's in all the Eucharistic prayers because we need him. We need him today more than we have ever needed him before. And this year is 2020, the year where all this chaos has broken out, where there's so much confusion in the church, which Our Lady talked about, by the way, in 1973 in Akita, Japan, an approved apparition where she said there will come a time when there will be bishops against bishops, priests against priests. We are living that today, my friends. Anybody and everybody can see this. And so 2020, all this is crescendoing right now. What year is this? Oh, that's right. The 150th anniversary of when St. Joseph was proclaimed the patron of the Universal Church. 1870 to 2020. Perfect. Now's the time of Saint Joseph. He is this powerful spiritual weapon that we need to bring onto the battlefield. And one of his greatest titles, my particular favorite, and the title of this image behind me that I commissioned for the book, and I'll talk about some of that artwork in a minute. One of his titles in the Litany of Saint Joseph, officially approved by the church, he is the terror of demons. They flee at the mere mention of his name. Why? Because remember, he saved the Savior. He has paternal intercessory power with the God-man. He can talk to Jesus in ways that you and I cannot. There's only two people who can say this prayer: my Jesus, my Savior, and my Son. And it ain't you and me. It's Mary and Joseph. When Jesus hears those words, a petition from St. Joseph, consider it done. Just like when Mary said, "Son, they have no wine." And then there was a lot of wine. Ask St. Joseph for his intercession, and the devils know its power, and they flee. This is what we need more of today. The praying of the rosary, you betcha. The fasting, big time. And we need to bring St. Joseph into this battle because he is mighty and he is strong. And so to help supplement with this book, I commissioned artwork for this whole project because many people, you know, if you ask them, what's your image of St. Joseph? They will say, well, he was old. He wasn't much involved. He was kind of just there, more like a babysitter, really, or a grandpa, you know, figure. That's what they've seen in art. But, you know, the Catholic Church has never said that he was old. Never. Matter of fact, all that stuff about him being two or three times older than the Blessed Virgin Mary comes from apocryphal literature, meaning non-approved, non-inspired, and, you know, not nowhere near on the same level as sacred scripture. But it makes a lot of sense that he would have been younger. Not as young as the Blessed Virgin Mary, of course, but certainly not 90 years old, like some of these texts have said. The things that were required of him, the walking, the working, the modeling of manhood for Jesus as he grew. He would have been strong. He was what's called a tecton, which means a carpenter and a stonemason. He worked with his hands. He was a healthy, strong man. Needed to be for the things that were required of him. And so I wanted to commission artwork that showed that. And so that's what I did. And you can see them in the back of the book. They're in the back of the book. And I'll tell you a website in a second where you can actually purchase some of these items and the book as well. But since I got you a captive audience here, I want to show you, I'm going to step aside, this one. You can't see the whole thing. At the bottom, there's a serpent that the lily staff that Jesus is holding of his father is piercing that serpent. It's a beautiful image. And St. Joseph has this look like enough. See, that's the look that we need today from fathers, to say enough of this chaos, enough of this confusion, enough of this rioting and looting. We need to get order. We need to return to virtue. We need to be protectors of beauty and truth and what is good. This is the real St. Joseph. And I'll show you some other images that I commissioned as well. And by the way, the smaller ones, like here's a smaller one, as you can see, it's big, but it's not like this. You can't buy them in this size, just so you know. A lot of people ask. I own the image, so I was able to get a special bigger one. But these you can get. So this is the same one. This is the Immaculata in the Tarot of Demons. Look at this. See, if couples were to see a model like this of fatherhood, of motherhood, of a man and a woman, of him willing to protect her, defend her, and her honoring her. Look at that loving gaze and her loving gaze upon him. They loved each other. Yes, they never entered into marital relations because this was a virginal marriage for the sake of the mission that was given to them in Jesus. But look at that love, that gaze. We as a culture need to return to this. This is what children need to be seeing today. Not all this filth on television. We need to return to virtue in our families. There's another one that I would like for you to see. It's also called St. Joseph, the Terror of Demons, where there's a serpent and that lily staff is piercing the serpents through his mouth. And St. Joseph is holding an axe because he was a carpenter. See, this is an incredible image of St. Joseph. And so there's a lot more of these kind of images that I could show you, but you can find them in the book and on the website. And so, my friends, if you gain anything from this talk, I pray that it's this. Go to Joseph. Go to Joseph in your particular situation. You know, it was Pharaoh, a pagan in the Old Testament, who told the people during the time of famine, he said to them, and this is where we get the phrase, go to Joseph, Pharaoh said. Well, now I, as your brother and as a Catholic priest, I urge you in this time that we're living in, go to Joseph. Go to him with all your needs, your struggles, your difficulties, your hardships. If you're worried about your future, your finances, your job, remember, he is the model workman. We have a feast day for him, May 1st, St. Joseph the Worker. Don't leave out Joseph. Go to him if your marriage is having problems, if your children have gone astray, go to Joseph. If your health is not good, go to Joseph. And if you can, I do urge you to get this book, Consecration to St. Joseph. There's many places you can get it. It's spreading all around the world, and it'll be available in Spanish later in this year and many other languages. But there's a website where you can get it. It's consecrationtostjoseph.org. And you don't spell out the saint part, it's just ST. That's consecrationtostjoseph.org. I'm going to be praying for you, and please pray for me. And together, let's help to right some of these wrongs that are happening in our culture and even in our church. And let us turn to the powerful and mighty terror of demons, the great Saint Joseph. God bless you all.
Thank you, Father Calloway, and thank you for watching. Please visit our website at ignitedbytruth.org, and you'll find the schedule for the Truth Series, as well as a link to the upcoming presentations. This talk is free. Please share it with others. Donations are gratefully accepted on our website as well. We hope you'll watch the other Truth Series videos available right here for free on the Ignited by Truth YouTube channel. Join us on September 5th to watch Father Chad Ripperger, an exorcist, an expert in spiritual warfare and exorcism.